in the usual video. And I remind you also that the meeting is streamed live on YouTube, and we will have the link in the chat in a few seconds. Let's wait another minute and then we start the video.
Laura was born on 29 of October 1711. In 1732, she earned the degree of Doctor in Philosophy from the University of Bologna. A few months later, because of her remarkable scientific skills, the Senate of the University assigned her an honorary position at the chair of Philosophia Universa, that is, of natural philosophy. In the following years, the young woman continued to study. In 1738, she married Giuseppe Veratti, a doctor in medicine who shared with his wife a keen interest in the study of nature. In 1745, Pope Benedict XIII admitted Laura Bassi among the elite group of scholars named Benedictine Academics, but only as a supernumerary, and not without resistance. Filling this role, she had to present at least one original dissertation a year. In this way, Laura played an active role inside the Bolognese scientific community. For performing her talks, Laura carried out several experiments with her husband in her own home, in a special laboratory that the couple had equipped with the most advanced tools and machines of the time. This laboratory was used not only for her personal research, but also for the private lessons in experimental physics that Laura Bassi held for philosophy and medical students of the university. The almost 30 years of high-level lessons held by Laura at her home earned her the assignment of the position, this time effective, of Professor of Experimental Physics in the Institute of Sciences in 1776. Only 2 years later, on the morning of February 20, 1778, Laura Bassi died suddenly, after having participated in a session of the Academy of Sciences the previous evening. This woman, a forerunner of female emancipation, remains an admirable example for all women of science still today.
Okay, so welcome again to today's Laura Bassi colloquium. And it's a pleasure for me today to introduce today's speaker, that is Cecilia Bacchini, as she is currently working my own research group here in Padova. So a few words about Cecilia's work so far. So Cecilia got her PhD, actually a double PhD, in 2020, both at the Bologna University in Italy and at the Groningen University in the Netherlands, working on the star formation nearby galaxies as traced by the cold gas components. And she took particular care in modeling their extension within the galaxy disks. Now, thanks to this work, she won two important prizes for early career scientists in astrophysics. One is the 2020 IAU PhD Prize for the best thesis in interstellar matter and local universe. And the second one is the Livio Gratton Prize for the best Italian PhD thesis in astrophysics. Cecilia is now a postdoc, as I said, at the Padova Astronomical Observatory, where she works in the team led by Bianca Poggianti to characterize the evolution of galaxies in clusters. And now, before leaving the floor to Cecilia, I remind you that we will have some time for questions at the end of this colloquium, which is supposed to last about 45 minutes. You can book your slot for questions by raising your hand in Zoom, and someone will be monitoring the chat as well in case your microphone is not working properly. Cecilia, is this now your turn? And I send a message or something like this 5 minutes before the end of the talk, if that is okay for you.
Yes, thank you, Alessia, for your nice introduction. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to give this talk and to present my work. As Alessia said, the work that I'm going to present is mainly based on what I've done during my PhD that I did at the University of Groningen and the University of Bologna, which were the alma mater of these two notable women in academia, Aletta Jacobs and Laura Bassi herself. So before starting with the work that I've done, I would like to introduce what is the fil rouge that runs throughout my talk and also the work that I've done during my PhD. And the fil rouge is this. So basically, when we observe a galaxy, we see it in projection in the sky plane. So if we observe, we can observe a disk of stars looking in optical wavelengths, but we can also observe the disk of gas, for instance, like the atomic gas disk when we have radio telescopes. And so these disks seem thin, but actually they are not, because gas disk in galaxies are thick, and most importantly, they have the so-called flaring, so their thickness increases with increasing distance from the galaxy center. And this is expected because gas disk in galaxies are expected to be in hydrostatic equilibrium, so we have that the gas pressure tends to inflate the disk, while the gravity tends to push the gas towards the galaxy midplane. But since gravity weakens with increasing galactocentric distance, we have that the net effect is a flaring, an increase of the thickness. So the scale height of the gas disk increases with increasing galactocentric radius. And this is expected, but also observed. For instance, in our galaxy, we can see here, the scale height, so the thickness of the gas disk of atomic gas in our galaxy, increases with increasing distance from the center. And this is also visible in nearby galaxies, despite measuring the thickness is very, very hard in external galaxies. You can clearly see from the central panel that the molecular gas disk show clear signs of a flaring, and also the atomic gas disk in this very inclined galaxies shows signs of a flaring. And this brings me to what is the main part of my talk, which is about volumetric star formation laws in nearby galaxies. Let me start with introducing star formation laws and why star formation laws are very important. So star formation laws, as you probably know, link the amount of gas in a galaxy with the star formation rate of this galaxy. And it is a key ingredient of any model of galaxy formation and evolution. For instance, here you have a gas disk in a cosmological simulation, and we want to form also a disk of stars, of course. And to do so, we need a star formation law. This is an example of the typical recipe that is the subgrid physics that is implemented in numerical simulations. And as you can see, the assumption is typically that the star formation rate is zero below a certain gas threshold, while above this threshold we have that the star formation rate is given by a star formation efficiency epsilon and the gas density to the power of 1.5. But where does this prescription come from? Well, it comes from empirical relations, of course. And the most famous one is the Kenny-Kazimith relation that links the surface density of the gas and the surface density of the star formation rate. And it is a power law with slope 1.4. Here you can see an example of the so-called global Schmidt-Kennicott law. So each point is an average within the star-forming disk of galaxies. And as you can see, the slope is 1.4 in the high-density regime. But when we look actually at low densities, so densities below 10 solar masses per parsec square, we can see that this relation has a break. So the slope changes and the relation is no more valid. And this is even more evident when we look at spatially resolved galaxies. There is a clear break at the local 10 solar masses per parsec square, and this is the so-called local Kennicott-Schmidt law. So here the points are represented as contours, and many galaxies are plotted together, and we are seeing measurements of the surface densities from in different pixels inside many galaxies. So other empirical relations have been proposed, and probably the most famous one is the so-called molecular Schmidt-Kennicott relation, which is a linear correlation between the surface density of the molecular gas and the star formation rate. However, this relation holds only where we can measure the CO emissions, so typically within the stellar disk, but we also know that we see star formation also in the outskirts of galaxies, well beyond the diameter, the effective radius of the stellar disk. So this relation, molecular correlation, doesn't hold in these environments, because these environments are dominated by atomic gas. And as we can see in the right panel, we do not see any correlation between the surface density of the atomic gas and the star formation rate when we look at the outskirts of galaxies. So the result is that we do not have a single relation for both high density and low density star forming regions of galaxies. And this brings me to the idea behind our work, the work that we did on star formation laws. And basically the idea is to take into account of the disk thickness, but most importantly of the disk flaring. So if the observed surface densities, which are used for the Kennicott-Schmidt law, are projected densities, we can take into account this, and we can solve this integral, assuming a vertical profile for the gas. And we basically obtain a volume equation for the volume density, which is given a volume density as a function of the galactocentric distance, which is given by the ratio between the surface density and the scale height, the thickness of the disk. And we will use this to derive our volumetric star formation law. So let me start to tell you which ingredients we need. And we need the volume densities, of course, of the atomic gas, the molecular gas, and the star formation rate. And we know that we observe the surface densities, but we need to find the scale heights, the thickness of this disk, the scale heights of the distributions. And I will start telling you how to find the scale height for the gas, because it is simpler, while the star formation rate requires an ad hoc discussion. So with the gas, we can assume the hydrostatic equilibrium, as I told you before. And thanks to this assumption, we learn that the thickness, the scale height of the gas disk, is proportional to the velocity dispersion of the gas, which has a trend with the galactocentric distance, and the galaxy potential, which must include not only the stellar disk potential, but also the dark matter, because it is dominant in the outskirts of galaxies, and is very important in particular for dwarf galaxies, but also the gas self-gravity, which is also very important for dwarf galaxies. So To test this approach and to derive our volumetric star formation law, we used a sample of 12 galaxies to start, 10 spiral galaxies and 2 dwarf galaxies from the survey things. We chose these galaxies because they have a mass model already available in the literature, derived from the decomposition of the rotation curve, and we used these mass models to derive the gravitational potential by numerical integration. And these galaxies also have the surface densities of the atomic gas, the molecular gas, and the star formation rate. For these galaxies, we have in particular also measurements, estimates of the CO to H2 conversion factor done for each galaxy and as a function of the radius. So the surface densities for the molecular gas were the best we could use. But what we miss now, we miss only one ingredient to derive the scalite, which is the gas velocity dispersion. And this is actually not very easy to measure, but we used the software 3D Barolo to do this. And 3D Barolo performs a tilted ring model fitting directly on emission line data cubes, so in 3D, and can take into account of the beam smearing and allow us to obtain a very accurate measurement of the velocity dispersion. So we derived the velocity dispersion for each galaxy in our sample, and as you can see from the radial profile for this spiral galaxy, there is a decreasing trend with the radius of the velocity dispersion of the gas. And so now we have everything that we need to derive the gas scalate, and we used a Python module called Galpynamics that was developed by Giuliano Iorio during his PhD. This code is based on the hydrostatic equilibrium, and it has an iterative algorithm that derives the scalite, accounting also for the gas set gravity. So we obtained the scalite for all the galaxies in our sample, and as you can see here from the example, the thickness, the scalite of the H1 disk has a significant flaring with the radius, it increases of a factor 6. And so it is very important to take into account this. For the molecular gas, the flaring is less important, but simply because the molecular gas is less extended than the H1. So my take-home message from this very first part is that assuming a constant thickness for gas disk in galaxies is not a good approximation, because they are thick and moreover they are flaring. So this is very important to take into account. So having said this, we now have a method to derive the volume densities for the gas components, but we still don't know the scalite of the distribution of the star formation rate. So we did not have any constraint on it, so we had to make two extreme assumptions. The first is a constant value, the same for all the galaxies and constant with the galactocentric distance. The second choice was based on the idea that the star formation rate must have the same vertical distribution as the gas, simply because the stars fall from the gas. And we used this prescription, this weighted average of the H1 and the H2 scalates, weighted by the gas fractions. And as you can see from the black dashed line, this second choice, give us a flaring profile also for the scalate of the star formation rate, which is between the H1 and the H2 scalates in the inner regions where we have both atomic and molecular gas, but it is coincident with the atomic gas scalate when we are in H1 dominating environments. So now that we have everything to derive our volume densities, we can build a volumetric star formation law. And I will start by showing you the example for a single galaxy, NGC 5055, a spiral galaxy with an extended star forming disk. However, in this very first part, I will focus only in the regions that are within the stellar disk. So I will deal with the outskirts later. So for this galaxy, we have the azimuthally average averaged radial profiles for the surface densities, and we have that the high density points come from the inner regions of the disk where the disk is thin, while the low density points are from the outskirts where the disk is thick. When we use the volume densities and we take into account only the flaring for the gas, we obtain the central panel, and when we include the flaring also from the star formation rate, we obtain the right panel. And as you can see, we are stretching in the central panel, we are stretching the points along the x-axis, while in the right panel, we are stretching the points also along the y-axis. So, but what do we obtain for all the galaxies? Well, this is the surface density, surface-based relation. As you can see, some galaxies seem to follow the Kennicott law, but other galaxies do not follow the relation. They clearly depart from it, and there is a break at 10 solar masses per parsec square, as I told you at the beginning. And this is typically interpreted as the presence of a density threshold for star formation, as I showed you at the very beginning of the talk. But when we use the volume densities, we actually find that all the galaxies seem to follow the same tight correlation, notwithstanding our choice of the scale of the star formation rate. And that there is no break in this relation, which suggests that there is no density threshold for star formation. But let me derive the slope and the scatter of this volumetric star formation law. Well, here the points are shown as contours, and we fitted the power law to our volume densities, and we found that the scatter of this relation is very small, much smaller than the scatter in the Kennicott unit relation. And the slope, unfortunately, is unconstrained, not well constrained, because is between 1.4 or 2. And two, but since we do not know which is the correct choice for the star formation rate scale, we cannot, we do not know which is the correct slope for the relation. And to overcome this issue, our idea was to look at our galaxy, because in our galaxy we have a privileged point of view, and we can measure the scalars directly from observations, as I told you at the beginning. And we decided so to measure the scalet of the star formation rate distribution in our galaxy directly from observations. But observations of what? We choose the classical cepheids, because they are very young stars, and their position in the galaxy can be, their distance can be measured in an accurate way. And so we measured the scalet for classical cepheids, and using data available in the literature, and we found that there is a clear flaring of the distribution of classical cepheids in our galaxy. But is this flaring the same as our prescription for the star formation rate scalate? Do you remember the weighted average that we chose before? Well, the answer is yes, because these two scalates are really very, very similar. So the distribution of classical cepheids, so traces of recent star formation, this scalet resembles the scalet of the gas in hydrostatic equilibrium. It has a flaring. So our second choice was the best choice. And assuming that the star formation rate distribution has a constant thickness, has a constant scalet with the galactocentric distance, instead is not a good approximation. So we called the test, also we could also build our volumetric star formation law in the Milky Way. So this is the situation for the surface-based law. As you can see, the Milky Way behaves as the other galaxies, so below a certain density, it departs from the Kennicott-Schmidt law. But when we use the volume densities, we find instead that the Milky Way follows remarkably well our volumetric star formation law. And I would like to stress that now we know which is the correct slope. We can derive, we can obtain a single slope for the volumetric law. So far, I've shown you only points that are within the stellar disk, but what about low density environment? What about the outskirts of galaxies? Well, to test the volumetric star formation law in these extreme regions that are still star forming, we decided to look at nearby dwarf galaxies. And so, following the same approach as before, we selected a sample of 10 galaxies from the survey Little Things, but we also extended the analysis of the galaxies we have studied before by simply extended the profiles that we take into account. So we extended the study beyond the stellar disk, because we have galaxies that are also among the so-called extended UV disks, so star formation is observed really at distances much larger than the optical radius. So these galaxies have, again, mass models in the literature, so we could derive the gravitational potential, and they also, the dwarf galaxies also have the surface density of each one and the star formation rate. And in this case, we are lucky because the dwarf galaxies were studied by Yori et al. In 2017, and he measured the velocity dispersion of the atomic gas using the software 3D Barolo. So we have already consistent profiles for the velocity dispersion, and we could promptly derive the thickness of the gas disk, the thickness of the gas disk in dwarf galaxies. As you can see from the left, the flaring is very significant also for dwarf galaxies. It's slightly smaller with respect to spiral galaxies, but simply because dwarf galaxies are smaller in diameter, I mean. Okay, so let me show you now what we find. So this is these are the points we have seen before, but as contours. And let me show you where the outermost star-forming regions of the galaxies we have studied in the first part of the talk end up. Well, as you can see in the surface-based plot, they depart from the Kennicott law as expected, but with the volume densities, they follow very well the volumetric star-formation law. So the volumetric star formation law is confirmed for also for the outermost star forming regions of our galaxies. But what about dwarf galaxies? Well, let me include the points in the contours and show you the 10 little things dwarf galaxies. They are this, and again, they depart from the Kennicott law, but follow very well the volumetric star formation law. Again, there is no density threshold because there is no break in the volumetric star formation law, at least not down to 10 to the minus 3 solar masses per parsec cube. But let me include the points in the contour, in the contours, and derive a new best fit now that we have a larger sample. The best fit now is this, and as you can see, the slope is 2. Is a quadratic power law, and the scatter is even smaller than before. The Milky Way still follows very well the new best fit relation. Now that we know the correct slope for the volumetric star formation law, we can follow the typical approach of interpreting the slope of this power law in this way. So we assume, as is typically done, that the star formation rate is given by the star formation efficiency, which is assumed constant, and the gas density divided by the star formation timescale. And the typical approach, the typical idea is that the gravitational instability drives star formation. So the time scale here is the free fall time scale, which is inversely proportional to the square root of the gas density. But this gives us a slope of 1.5, while we observe a slope of 2. So we need to find something else than gravitational instability, something which has a time scale that is inversely proportional to the gas density to obtain the power of 2. And what are the processes that likely play a role in star formation and have this kind of timescales? Well, these processes are cooling, so because, of course, in order to form stars, we need cold gas. So cooling is likely playing a role. But also the formation of H2 is likely important, and it has the correct time scale. So this is very interesting because it tells us that not only gravity plays a role in star formation. So having said this, at the beginning of the talk, perhaps you remember that I showed you that there are also other empirical relations that involve only the molecular gas or only the atomic gas. What happens when we use the volume densities also for these relations? Well, I will start showing you the so-called molecular chemical distribution relation. As you can see, with the surface densities, which are typically from spiral galaxies where we observe CO emission, we have a linear correlation, but this correlation is has a large scatter, and it quickly loses validity at low densities. And with the volume densities, actually the situation doesn't improve significantly. The scatter is still large. But this lack of significant improvement makes sense because, as I told you before, the flaring for the molecular gas disk is less significant in some way, but simply because the molecular disk is smaller than the atomic gas disk, for instance. And moreover, the molecular gas mass has an additional source of scatter that cannot be reduced by our method. And this source of scatter is the so-called CO2H2 conversion factor. We used accurate measurements, but some scatter may still come from that parameter. So let me now show you something that I found much more interesting, which is the correlation or lack of correlation between the atomic gas and the star formation rate. Because as you can see, here we have points from all both spiral and dwarf galaxies, but there is no correlation between the surface density of the atomic gas and the star formation rate. Actually, when we look at the volume densities, we find this tight correlation between the two quantities. A relation which is as tight as the volumetric star formation law involving the total gas that I showed you before. This relation is steeper, but still, this very tight correlation suggests that the H1 is actually a good tracer of the star forming gas, which is completely different from what we find when we look at the projected surface densities. So this brings to the conclusion of this first part of my talk. And so the first and probably most important thing is that the flaring of gas disks in galaxies is significant. So gas disks are not thin and do not have a constant thickness. Second, we have seen that there is this volumetric star formation law between the total gas and the star formation rate, which holds for both high-density and low-density regimes from dwarf galaxies to spiral galaxies. And to my knowledge, this is the only star formation law that holds for such a large diversity of star-forming environments. This relation involves the volume densities, so it is likely more fundamental than the relations based on the surface densities. It has no break, which suggests that there is no density threshold for star formation, and it is a quadratic power law, which suggests that not only gravity plays a role in star formation. And the third, we have seen that there is a correlation between the volume densities of the atomic gas only and the star formation rate, which suggests that the H1 can trace the star forming gas in particular conditions in galactic disks. So let me conclude the first part with the open questions on this topic. And the first one is, so it will be interesting to test the volumetric star formation law for starburst galaxies and also for high redshift galaxies, actually, but also in early type galaxies hosting a star forming disk. But probably the most important thing that is left to do and needs to be done is to measure the scale at directly from the observations, because we really need to test first the validity of the hydrostatic equilibrium and then our you know our derivation for the scalet, and but measuring the scalet from observations is very, very difficult because there are many things that can prevent one from measuring the scalet, and among these things there are, for instance, extraplanar gas, but also warps. If there is a warp, it's very, very difficult to disentangle the warp and the flaring of the gas disk. So let me move on and go to the second part of this talk, which is much shorter than the first part. This second part is about gas turbulence in nearby galaxies. Let me start by introducing a bit the ASM turbulence, so we know that the gas in galaxies, the ASM, is turbulent because we measure the broadening of emission lines. From the broadening of emission lines, we get the velocity dispersion of the gas, and this exceeds the values expected from the thermal speed only, so from the gas due to the gas temperature. And this additional broadening is typically ascribed to turbulence, so chaotic motions between portions of the gas. And the turbulence in the ASM, it is well described by the Kolmogorov's theory. And in this framework, we have that the kinetic energy of turbulence, so the turbulent kinetic energy is injected into the ASM at a certain driving scale, and then this energy is transferred because the turbulent eddies break down into smaller and smaller eddies, so they transfer this turbulent kinetic energy to smaller scales, and the energy is conserved until we reach the so-called dissipation scale, at which the gas viscosity converts this kinetic energy into internal energy of the gas. But the important thing here is that since we observe turbulence, this mechanism, this cascade of energy must be in a stationary state, because, and this means that the injection rate of energy must balance the dissipation rate. And this simply means that turbulence must be maintained by some energy source. In particular, this energy source must provide an injection rate of turbulent energy given by the ratio between the turbulent energy and the dissipation timescale. The dissipation timescale is the ratio between the driving scale, which is the physical scale of the system, and the turbulent velocity. The best candidates for being the drivers of turbulence, the energy source of turbulence in galaxies, are supernovae, because they are the most common and the most energetic phenomena in galaxies. And in particular, the energy injection rate by supernovae, the turbulent energy injection rate, can be estimated using this simple equation, which includes the energy of a single supernova. Then we have the star formation rate, of course, that can be derived from observations. We also have the fraction of the core collapse supernovae and the supernova efficiency. This parameter, the supernova efficiency eta, is the most important one, because it tells us the fraction of the total supernova energy that goes into feeding turbulence. And from analytical models and numerical simulations, we know that actually we have only a few percent of the total supernova energy which is available to feed the turbulence, because most of the energy is radiated away. And so eta is close to or lower than 0.1, which basically means that we have about 10% or a few percent of the supernova energy available to feed the turbulence. So having said this, how can we understand if supernovae are enough or not to explain, to feed the turbulence that we observe in galaxies? Well, of course we can make a comparison with observations, and in particular we can estimate the observed kinetic energy in the ASM. Here I put the example for the H1 gas. We need only the surface density of the gas and the velocity dispersion of the gas, and we can compare this with the turbulent energy from supernovae that is expected given the observed star formation rate, and we can estimate the efficiency that we need to make these two, to match these two quantities. This exercise was done by Tambur et al. In 2009. And as you can show, the observed energy, the observed kinetic energy in the ASM is shown as by the contours, while the green curves are the energy expected from supernovae. In particular, this was calculated by assuming that the driving scale, so the physical scale of the system, so of a galaxy disk, is 100 parsec, and that the turbulent velocity is 10 km per second, which basically means that we have a very quick dissipation in about 10 megaliers. And as you can see here, we have that the observed kinetic energy can be explained by supernovae with low efficiency only in the innermost regions of the disk, while when we move to larger radii, we need very high efficiencies incompatible with the expectations from the analytical and theoretical and the numerical models, or even unphysical efficiencies above one. So Tambur et al. Proposed that there is another mechanism that helps supernovae in feeding turbulence, which is the magnetorotation instability. As you can see here, it can explain the observed energy, more or less, but we still need very high efficiencies. The magnetorotation instability basically converts part of the kinetic, of the ordered kinetic energy of rotation of the disk into chaotic turbulent energy through the magnetic field. But actually, other authors proposed different mechanisms, so rotational shear to, as I said, to help supernovae, rotational shear, gas infall, or disk instabilities. In the end, however, we still don't know what is sustaining turbulence. It is only supernovae or supernovae plus something else. The idea behind our work was to take into account, again, that the flaring of gas disk is important also to solve this problem, because the physical scale of a galactic disk is, of course, its thickness. It's, so we have that the driving scale is proportional to the scale height of the disk, to its thickness. And this needs to be taken into account when we estimate the dissipation timescale of turbulence, because since the thickness of the disk increases with increasing distance from the galaxy center, also the dissipation timescale increases with increasing distance from the center, which means that the dissipation is slower in the outskirts of the disks. And I would like to note that compared to a thin disk with no flaring, so the assumption made by Tambur et al. 2009, the work I discussed before, we have a difference of one order of magnitude in the disk, in the outer regions of the disk. So it is very significant. What we did? Well, we took a sample of galaxies, two dwarf and eight spiral galaxies, and then we used a hierarchical Bayesian approach to compare the observed kinetic energy in the ASM and the expected energy from supernovae, plus the thermal energy of the gas, of course. And our aim is to measure the supernova efficiency and to check if this is compatible with the expectations from the models. We did this exercise for both the atomic gas and the molecular gas. For the atomic gas, we explored two, let's say, unrealistic cases in which the atomic gas is single phase and it's only either cold neutral medium or warm neutral medium, but we also explored, of course, the more realistic case in which we have a two-phase medium, a mixture of cold and warm neutral medium. In this case, we have an additional parameter, free parameter, which is the fraction of warm neutral medium. I don't
Virginia,
have time.
5 minutes.
Yeah, thank you. I don't have time to show you all the galaxies, so I will show you only a couple of galaxies and only the two extreme cases for the atomic gas, because they are very useful to understand, and the case of the molecular gas. So let's start from the atomic gas. This is the case in which we have assumed that it is all cold neutral medium. So we have the smallest possible contribution from the thermal energy in this case. And as you can see, the observed profile, the black points, the observed profile of the kinetic energy in the SM is well reproduced by our model in green. Our model that includes the thermal energy of the gas, which is almost negligible for the cold neutral medium, and the energy from supernovae. And in particular, here we have assumed that the supernova efficiency is constant with the radius, but despite this, we are able to reproduce the observed profile with a supernova efficiency which is very low, is only 0.04. So supernovae can reproduce the observed profile of the ISM energy, in the case of the H1, of course. This is the case for the warm neutral medium. Instead, here we have the largest possible contribution from the thermal energy. So here we can reproduce the observed profile even better, and we need clearly an even lower efficiency of supernovae. But again, I would like to note that this is done with the supernova efficiency, which is constant with the galactocentric radius, which is quite remarkable compared to the results obtained by the news works. And so we did this exercise for all the galaxies in our sample, in both the cases with cold neutral medium and warm neutral medium. And we also made the tests using a different estimate of the star formation rate from the observables. And we used these values in these tests to derive an average global value for the supernova efficiency in the case of the atomic gas. And as you can see here, this value is 0.02, basically. So only a few percent of the supernova energy is required to explain turbulence in the atomic gas in nearby galaxies, in agreement with the models, with the theoretical the expectations from theoretical models. And this is, let me show you the case for the atomic for the molecular gas. Again, in black, we have the black points are the observed profile, and in green, we have our model, and since it is molecular gas, the thermal energy is negligible in practice. And we have the tower model can reproduce well the observed profile with a supernova efficiency that is even lower than the one in the case of the atomic gas. We need less than 1% of the total supernova energy. And we obtain similar profiles for all the galaxies in our sample, for those that have CO detections, CO emission detections, and also changing the star formation rate surface density estimate. So we derived the global average value also for the molecular gas, and it is very, very low, as I told you. So now I can go to the conclusions. This is the second part of my talk, which is that only a few percent of the total supernova energy is required to sustain turbulence in the cold gas of galaxies. So we do not need an additional source of energy, at least not, it is not mandatory to include it. And this few percent is perfectly in agreement with the expectations of analytical and numerical models of the evolution of supernova remnants. And I would also like to note that the contribution of thermal energy is significant in the outer regions of galaxies where the star formation rate is low. So with this, I conclude. I am done, and I leave you with the summary of the conclusions. So thank you for your attention, and I'm very happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Cecilia, also for being perfectly on time. So if there's any question, that's the right time. If not, well, while people think, I start.
Mm-hmm.
So, what have meant these two prizes that you won after your PhD?
What meant? Well,
yes, I mean, it's a recognition for your effort, I would say. But
yeah. No, I was, of course, very, very happy because you know very well doing the PhD is. You know, it takes a lot of effort, not only by me, but also by my supervisors and the other collaborators. So it was really something that made happy a lot of people, not only me, but also the others. So it was a very, very nice thing. A very good excuse to celebrate many times.
Yeah, I see the point. So I also have a scientific question, but I suppose I shall be doing it during our coffee break but at the Institute. But if nobody has any other question for the time being. So going back to the first part of your talk, when you demonstrated that in the volumetric star formation law, there is a strong connection between star formation rate and H1, is this suggesting that you can simply say form stars from H1 without going through the molecular gas phase in certain condition?
Taken at face value, it means that, but which is possible in very particular conditions, very low metallicity, and for instance, if the time scale of the formation of molecular gas is longer than the time scale for cooling or for you know, the process that regulates star formation. But actually, we also know that there is a lot of CO dark gas in this kind of environments. So probably it simply means that. But I think that the most interesting thing is that this correlation tells us that the H1 can trace the bulk of the gas that is participating in star formation, at least on a scale of a few hundred of parsecs, which is the scale that of the observations that I used.
I see. Thanks. Is there any other question from the audience? Someone is looking at the chat as well. No. Okay. I have another curiosity.
It's always clear.
Yes. No, wait, you always have been very clear. But I have another curiosity that's more personal, let's say. So since you've studied here and abroad at the same time, let's say, what is the biggest difference that you find in these two environments, here and the Netherlands, from the research point of view?
Yes. Okay, I think that the most striking difference was the treatment for PhD students, because in the Netherlands you can be, you know, you are basically a researcher, you're not a student, at least not like in Italy, you're really let's say, almost an adult researcher, while in Italy you are considered a bit as a student. So I have to say that I found this situation very, very, you know, striking, and I have to say that I preferred the Dutch way.
Well, you are young enough, you can change the world.
No, but also it was really a privilege to have the opportunity to do the PhD in two institutes, two major institutes. So the double degree was really something unexpected, but very, very instructive. So
thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think we are kind of running out of time. So we thank again our speaker, Cecilia, that has given a very, very nice talk. And see you next time, the next month, for the Laura Colloquium, Laura Bassi Colloquium. And we will have Tirna Deb next month. See you. Thank you, everybody.